I'll be discussing about buffer overflow using the challenge BOF from InCTF mock round. So first of all, let's talk about stack. What is stack? When a program calls a function, it needs this place to store the local variables which are called inside the function, and also need the space to store the answers which are created inside the function. For this, it uses a memory space called as stack. We can push addresses onto stack or values onto stack, and we can pop the values from stack. Now, let's talk about what happens when a function is called. When a function is called, the address of that function to where the address to where the program should return to is stored on the stack before it goes into the function. This is because when the function is over, the program needs to know where it should return to, where the control is given back. Otherwise, it will be at a point where it does not know where it should go to. So the return address will be stored onto the stack. Then there will be an EBB which will be saved on the stack. This is because there is only one EBP, and currently we'll be using that EBP to locate the base pointer of the current stack frame of the current function. So if we want to go back to the stack frame of the old function, we'll be saving that EBP, and we'll be returning to the old stack frame. Now let's talk about the vulnerability buffer overflow. Why this vulnerability happens, and what we can use it to. Let's see what the stack looks like when the function is called. Here there is a return address, and there will be a saved EBP here, and this will be the stack frame of the new function. Okay, consider this is our buffer. So consider that we have an overflow in this buffer. That means we can give more data than the space allocated by the program. So what will happen? The buffer will go from this address to upward, that is to higher address. So if we overflow this buffer, we can override the local variables, and also we can override the return address. That means we can control the place to which the function should return to. What will happen if this address is some junk? The program will set fault because the program is trying to return to an address which does not exist. What if this is a real address? What if this address is of some function which gives us some privileges? So when the program returns, it returns to a place where we want it to return to. Okay, now let's look at the code of our function. In this program, you can see here we are using getters to take input into buffer. The buffer size is 10. The problem with getters is that getters won't stop until it encounters a slasher. That means it will go on take input without stopping. So if our input is larger than 10 bytes, it will overflow. So in this program we are given a winner function. So we know where we should return to. We just need to return to the winner function, and the flag will be printed. Okay, so let's see the disassembly of that. So here is the exploit me function. Here is the getters. The address to where the getters starts writing is ABP-0xA, which is 10 bytes. So that means we need to write 14 bytes to get to the address, because I already told you there will be a saved EBP on the stack. So we need to override the buffer, fill the buffer, override the EBP, and we'll get to the return address. Let's see the address of our winner function. This is the address of the winner function. Let's just write a small bash script. Let's give 14 bytes of chunk. We should give it in little Indian form, and we should reverse it because the input will be taken in the reverse order. So if we just pipe it to the function, here you can see we got the flag. It went into segmentation fault because the program did not itself go into the winner. We made it go into the winner function. That means the program now doesn't know where to return to. Like, we overwrote the EBP with AAAA. So our stack frame will be illegal. That's why it's set faulted. But before that, we got the flag. Next, I'll be talking about the challenge, cheating. Let's just jump into the code and see what's the problem with the code. So this is just a basic comparison program. So this program just takes our input, then it compares it with the saved password, and if it is equal, we'll get a shell. So there are two problems in this program. One problem is that the size of our buffer is only 512 bytes, but we can input 1025 bytes. Right, and the other problem is the program uses strcmp instead of strncmp. Strcmp doesn't have a size constraint. That means the function doesn't care the length of both the inputs. So what will happen is when it encounters a null, it will stop at that point. That means what we can do is we can just give some values and a slash zero, right? Then we can fill the entire buffer. Then we can overflow into the default password because the default password is just above our ended password. So we can overflow into the default password and give some junk and then a null. If both in both places we give the same junk values, the string strcmp will pass and we'll get a shell. So let's write the bash script for this. This A is for the first buffer. Then we'll just multiply this with 511 so that our buffer is filled, and we'll give we just need to give 510 here because the total size is 512. Here it will be 510, then here 2 bytes. So the entire buffer is filled. Then this A will come. Okay. Let's see what happens inside GDB. It goes into the authenticate function. Then it's loading the saved buffer onto the registers. Okay. Now the program will ask for our input. here is our input being taken. Now let's see what the arguments for strcmp is. As you can see, even though the first buffer is 61 null then a slash x0a, it is not going to consider this part because the strcmp will stop when it encounters this null. That means it will only take this a, 0x1 is a by the way, and this a. That means our check will be passed and wait for it, we get a shell. So what we need to do is we just need to cat the input. The reason why I'm giving another cat is because the shell will close as soon as it is created. So if I want the shell to be kept open, I'll just give another cat. As you can see, got a shell. That's it for the cheating. Hope you understood.
Today I'm going to be explaining you about return-oriented programming. The concept of return-oriented programming arises only if you have another bug in the binary. And what that bug could be, we will just understand this with the help of a C code. This is the challenge that was given in the InCTF calls mock round. Okay, let's have a look. In the main function, we have a buffer of size 16. And we also have a read. A read which is reading an input of 0x100 bytes. It means 256 bytes into that buffer. The size of our buffer is 16. And we are reading 256 bytes into the buffer, which actually means that there is a buffer overflow. It means I can give a size of more than 16, overflow the buffer, and execute arbitrary code. Let us have a look at this layout of the stack. Top of the stack is here. And as you know, stack grows from higher memory addresses to lower memory addresses. By filling the buffer, I will be able to overwrite the return address. The return address actually is the address to which the function should return to after its execution. So, if we can overwrite this return address with an address that executes our arbitrary code, it means that executes the code that we want to execute, that is called as return-oriented programming, ROP. And for that, you might have to overwrite the return address multiple times, creating a chain of addresses after overwriting the return address. This chain is called the ROP chain. So, in today's challenge, we will be seeing how we can create a ROP chain, and we'll also be seeing the concept of leaking memory addresses from the binary. What leaking is, we will get to know soon. We'll also be understanding how we can set arguments to get a shell. So, let us begin, friends. So, we have analyzed the code. The code is nothing, it is just having a buffer of size 16 and it is taking 256 bytes into that buffer. So we have buffer overflow. And if we check the mitigations that binary has, mitigations are just, they are kind of protection modules for the binary. If one or more are enabled, attacks like buffer overflow or return-oriented programming can be avoided. So let us execute the command checksec. So it says that canary is disabled. It means we can successfully exploit with buffer overflow. Since we also have the vulnerability in our C code, we can successfully use this exploit. We also have fortify disabled. Fortify is basically the mitigation for format strings that is used for leaking memory addresses. NX is actually used for shell code. So you cannot simply give arbitrary assembly code, assembly instructions on the return value. Basically what NX does is, it just makes all the sections either read-write or read-executable. If any section in the binary is read-write-executable, then you can have the possibility of giving a shellcode. Next comes the PIE. PIE stands for Position Independent Executable. It stands for Position Independent Executable. If this mitigation is disabled, then memory addresses in the binary will not be changing. They will be constant. The memory addresses that have to be constant. For example, consider the memory address of code section. It has only read executable permissions, if you can see. And its address will be constant all over the multiple runs. The address of code section will be constant. The address of a section called BSS, which is used for storing global variables, will be constant. So we can use these addresses to our advantage. In today's session, we are going to use the mitigation of PIE, Position Independent Executable, for executing ROP chains. If this Position Independent Executable is disabled, it means that the read executable sections of the binary are not changing. So we can easily find suitable gadgets, okay? For ROP, we use certain suitable gadgets which cater to our needs. So what these gadgets could be, we will analyze now. Since we have buffer overflow, I can now override the return value with something. So let me just execute. You might need to install ROP gadget. This is a standard ROP chain finding tool. So the syntax for using it is ROP gadget minus minus binary and then dot slash the name of your binary. So we will have a lot of assembly snippets, okay? These are nothing but ways of exploiting the binary to execute our code. How do you exploit them? How do you exploit the binary using these addresses, these code snippets? Okay, so if you carefully see, we have lot of pop R12, pop register R13, and so on and so forth. We have pop RBP, we have other gadgets also. We have pop RDI, we have pop RSI, we have pop, we have lot of instructions. We have a return instruction also, just a simple RET. So, now I want you to understand how we can call suitable syscalls to get shell code, to get shell. The syscall for calling a shell is called execv. So I will just, you just have to see the arguments that are passed in the assembly, and you should duplicate whatever the arguments of execv are and call the shell. So we'll be just googling for 64-bit syscall arguments. So now we'll be seeing what exactly are the arguments that we have to create. See, here is the value of register RAX. Let us say I want to call read function. If I have to call read function, I have to ensure that register RAX has the value 0, RDI has the value of file descriptor. See, for functions which read input, The file descriptor is standard std in, which is 0. 0 is for input and 1 is for output. The write syscall uses the file descriptor 1 to write to std out. And if you see, RSI is the buffer that you have to write whatever you have read into, and the size is stored in RDX. Similarly, we have the execve syscall. Mind you, for executing execve in 64-bit, you need to have RAX set to 59 and RDI should have a pointer to /bin/sh. This is a very important thing, my friends. We don't have to simply give the string /bin/sh. We have to write it to some place and take that address which contains this value. You will get to know it soon. So this should be a pointer to /bin/sh, RDI. RSI and RDX can be pointers to null or null. So in today's session, we'll be learning how to call execve syscall using ROP chains. So we can successfully write our exploit now. But first, to execute a ROP chain, you need to have a ROP gadget called syscall. Do we have a ROP gadget called syscall? We'll just grep for it. Okay, so we don't have a ROP gadget called syscall. Then we have to follow the traditional method of calling systemof/bin/sh. This system function is a standard C function. So now you can guess, we have to get a standard C library leak, a libc leak. To get a libc leak, we have to set our registers and call putes. So how do you get a libc leak? To get a libc leak, we need a pointer to a libc function. But where can we have a pointer to libc? Pointers to libc are stored in the global offset table, the GOT table. Since the PIE mitigation is disabled, the GOT table is actually a small table which contains all the functions along with their PLTs or their libc addresses. Function, if it is called once, this is a very important point to remember. When a function is called for the first time, it is resolved. Resolved means the global offset table gives it a valid libc address once it is called for the first time. After that, you can use it as a pointer to libc function. Let us see the assembly of this. So my friends, let us see the assembly of this. Before calling read, I have putes being called. So let me show you the GOT table. The GOT table can also be accessed with objdump -r /our binary's name. So these are the offsets at which the GOT table stores the addresses of libc. Let me copy the offset of libc start main. Since libc start main has been called once, see, main is called from libc start main. It means, since we are in the main function right now, libc start main has already been called. So let us just dereference this with x/dx. So let us do a VM map on the address that we just found. Yes, here you go. This is a standard C address. This is the standard libc address. Now we can use this address as a pointer to a libc address, which is what we want. So now our plan is to call putes with this address as the argument. If we call putes with this as the argument, it will dereference this address and print what is there at this address. So Nothing but it will give you the leak, the Libc leak. So, first we overwrite the return address with the value of RDI we have to set to this address. So we do a pop RDI. Pop RDI from the stack. So I will write one simple drop chain now. So I'll be using pawn tools to write my exploit. So we are making our process interactive. Now we'll be sending our input. The binary does not print anything. Yeah, it does print as something. What does it print? We'll have a look. Okay, so we will receive until here and then send our input. Pawn tools is actually a way in with which we can communicate with the binary, okay? So now we can send. First we have to overwrite the value of the buffer, then we overwrite the base pointer RBP, and then we overwrite the return address. I'll show you how. So this, with this first 16 A's, we have filled the buffer. Now we overwrite the value of RBP. Let us set RBP to a BSS address. A BSS address does not change. Hence, we can use it dynamically. Let me dereference a huge offset such that we don't have alignment issues later on. I am taking this address and storing it in RBP. Okay. So, we will use P64 since 64-bit, we have to encode the register into Little Endian format. So for encoding it in Little Endian format, using pawn tools, we use P64. So now P64 of RBP plus. Now we have to set the value of the register RDI. See, in 64-bit, arguments to a function are passed with the help of registers. The first 6 arguments are passed with the help of 6 registers: RDI, RSI, RDX, then R12, R13, R14. So these 6 registers will have the first 6 arguments. If a function has 6 arguments, then all of these registers will be used. If it has more than 6 arguments, then it will use the first 6 for registers, and later arguments will be stored on stack. This is a very important concept. For 64-bit assembly, we have arguments passed to a function using registers. See, since putters has only one argument, argument is nothing but, you can see here, in this code snippet, it is saying move our EDI to this address and then putters. Putters is called. So basically, we are setting the register RDI and then calling putters. Putters will dereference this address and print whatever is there inside. If I set this RDI to an address containing a Libc address, then it will print that Libc address. So in my case, I have chosen the address of Libc start main. Libc start main has already been resolved, hence its Libc address will be available on the BSS. So I'll be using it as a pointer to get my Libc leak. Okay, so let's write the exploit. Now I have to write I have to get the ROP gadget which pops RDI. We can also use GDB to search for ROP. We can use GDB to search for addresses of our ROP gadgets. If I press pop RDI, ROP search, it will give me the address of pop RDI. This is the address of pop RDI. Okay. So now we'll be using this as our return value. It pops RDI, but what should it pop? It should pop the address of libc start me. Or anything else. You can choose whatever libc address has been resolved. Let me choose stdout. Stdout's libc address is already available on the BSS. Hence, when putters is called, you will have the libc address leaked. Okay, so let me store this in a variable so that we have less confusion. So stdout is equal to stdout got. This is a valid got address. So stdout So now it pops stdout's got, and now we'll call putters. You have to call putters. It means now you have to get the PLT address of putters. To call putters, I will get the address of putters using functions, info functions. In this, I have putters at PLT's address. Calling this will merely give me the leak. Okay. It is important to note that I am calling putters at PLT. So I'll just name the variable putters PLT. PLT addresses are basically primary linkage table addresses which can be called without causing a change in the control flow of the binary. So P64 of putters. Putters PLT. Let's attach GDB and move through the program. Let's run our exploit script. Before running that, let me also set the debug mode on. Debug mode can help you understand how the input is going into the binary. We can set it with the use of context.log level is equal to debug. Now, let's run the exploit script. Okay, seems that we've done a mistake. Oh, it should be io.sendLine after. Okay, so carefully see that we have given the input. Okay, now we have overwritten the address of return value with the address of pop RDI. Okay, so first we pop RDI. Oh, this is also a valid libc address, but it's in the read-write permission. The offset to the libc base can be found out very easily. See, the libc base starts from where you can see libc. It means this is the base of libc. All the offsets that we'll be calculating henceforth will be from the base. Libc actually is it moves as whole. It randomizes, but offsets to other functions can be calculated once you have a leak. So now we pop RDI, and RDI will have the pointer to our libc address, and now we return to putters. Carefully see, at one point we will get the leak. Putters will print, it will dereference and print. See, here you go. This is the leak that we have got. So guys, now we'll be looking at how to get the leak. Okay. So, we'll be receiving the leak, the first 6 bytes of the leak, io.receive of 6 into libc. And in 64-bit binaries, we have all the addresses aligned to 8 bytes. Hence, we will also make this libc leak as 8 bytes by appending it with 2 nulls. Now, we will convert this libc leak into human readable format, which will be U64, unpacking 64 bits of leak. And now we do print leak is equal to hex of libc. Let us run the exploit now. Okay, we seem to have encountered an error. Let's analyze the error. The error says struct.error unpack requires a string of argument 8. But we have already given the argument of this U64 as 6 plus 2 8 bytes, which means that we have missed something. We have missed taking something. Let me just receive another line so that everything sets out. And now, okay. So I've received my leak. Now, let me also calculate the offset of different functions that I want to execute now. So let me attach GDB. Okay. So now I've got the leak. Okay guys, now let me calculate the offset of base from here. So we'll do a VM map. Now we should understand what the base is. The base will be the first libc address that you encounter, which means this is our base. So to get the offset of base from here, we will just subtract our leak, the base from the leak. So now we have got the value of base. So let me just write that in my exploit. Base is equal to libc minus this much offset. Also, I'll be needing a pointer to slash bin slash sh. A pointer to slash bin slash sh is always available in the libc. If I do a find of slash bin slash sh, I will get a pointer to this string slash bin slash sh. I can easily calculate its offset by subtracting the base from this. So from the base, it is at an offset of those many bytes. So bin sh is equal to base plus whatever you calculate from the base will be at an offset higher than the base. So it will be bin sh is equal to base plus that offset. Also, for our exploit, we'll be needing the address of system, which will be executing in the end. So getting the address of system from the base, we subtract the base from the system. So system becomes base plus this much offset. Now you can see that we, after executing putters, we jump to main. So in the main, again, all this will be called. So we have to again write the same kind of technique, which is first we overwrite the first 16 bytes, the buffer, then we give P64 of RBP, then we do P64 of. So the arguments of system, the first two arguments of system are passed into RDI and RSI. In RDI, there should be a pointer to /bin/sh as we have got here. Now, we need to pop RSI also. In order to pop RSI, we need to get the address of the instruction which says pop RSI. We'll do that by running our exploit once again. We'll just do a ROP search of pop RSI. So it gave us the address of pop RSI. Let me append this in my script. So we have the address of pop RSI. Okay. So if you carefully see pop RSI, there is pop RSI and pop R15. So we need to pop two values from the stack. RSI should be null, and hence we will pop two zeros from the stack. Okay, so we'll write pop RDI first, and then we'll pop the pointer to binsh. Now we'll add pop RSI. And we have to pop two values, because we saw that in pop RSI there is pop RSI as well as pop R15. So we need to pop off two values, and hence I am giving P64 of 0 into 2. Next we directly call system. So let's run the exploit fresh again and check. Okay, so you can carefully see that arguments have been clearly set on the stack. And you can see that we're calling pop RDI with binsh, pop RSI with two pop zeros, and then we're calling system. Let's continue and see what happens. So RDI is having an argument to binsh. Now RSI is popped, means the top value of stack is popped onto RSI. RSI has become null. R15 will also become null after this, and now we are calling system. So in system, we have finally got the shell. So this was the exploit for the ROP challenge from InCTF calls. Now I'll also be discussing about another challenge from InCTF calls, which was your name. So let us jump into the source code and check what the challenge is about. Okay, so in the main function we see that there is a function called noReason being called, a function called vuln being called, also a function pointer being called. So the noReason function has a buffer of size 1024 bytes, and input is being read from stdin of size 1025 bytes into the buffer. Fgetters is a very safe function which has a size check also. In the vuln function, there is a buffer of size 16 and there is an integer variable. This is an uninitialized pointer which we will use for our exploit right now. How we will exploit it, we will see it now. And we are scanning 15 bytes of input into the buffer, and we are also scanning the variable with %d. So let us look at the assembly and understand a little more deeper about this. So there is a function called noReason being called, which has the buffer ebb-0x40 and an input of 0x401 bytes is being read. In the vuln function, which is what we have to carefully analyze, the second input, it means the input to the variable thing, is being read from ebp-4. It means the value at ebp-4 is being overwritten with whatever input is. So this is what the exploit will be about. We will be overwriting the value of ebp-4 using this fgetters, using the function noReason, with the value of the function pointer, and we will be overwriting the function pointer with the value of the winner function, the address of winner function. So we'll be writing the exploit now. So I'll be using the PawnTools framework again to write my exploit. The interactive module is used to get a continuous shell. Now, so we'll be sending a line after receiving send a string for no reason along with a new line character. We'll be sending 1020 A's along with the address of the function pointer, because that is what we have to override. The function pointer is stored in the BSS. It's a global variable and its address can be seen from here in the assembly. So because that is what is being loaded into EAX, and EAX is being called in the further instruction. So the address of function pointer is being noted here. Now function pointer is called. So if you can see, we have successfully overwritten value of EBP minus 4 with the function pointer. Since our buffer is of size EBP minus 0x400, we have written 0x400 by, we have written, we have written 0x400 bytes minus 4. We have written 1020 bytes with junk value, and the last 4 bytes we have given as function pointer. So we have written the value of EBP minus 4 with the function pointer. Now the program asks to enter a string. This is of no significance, as we can enter anything which is less than 16. So I'll enter A into 4. So now the major thing is called the uninitialized pointer. So I enter a string. Now it asks to enter a number. So now examining the assembly, we identify that it is reading into the address of EBP minus 4 and EBP minus 4. So basically we are overwriting the value inside the function pointer. And what do we want the value to be? We want the value to be the address of winner function. So we'll give that. We'll give the address of winner function. But it has asked in the integer format, hence we have to convert it into integer first. So we'll do p slash d of this. So it has asked an integer, hence we'll give str of this. Let's attach GDB somewhere to see the assembly. Okay. So now we have given the input to our no reason function. You can see that the value at EBP minus 4 will be our function pointer. Okay, so now we'll be going into the one function, reading 4 bytes of junk into the enter a string function, and now overwriting the function pointer. You can see that it is pushed. It is pushed dword pointer of EBP minus 0x4. EBP minus 0x4 is this, and EBP minus 0x4 value is the function pointer. So we are overwriting the function pointer now with the value of winner. When we return from here and we call EAX, will be going into the shell function which gives us a shell. So this was the exploit for your name. Thank you for watching this video, guys.